got your Bible, I want you to turn to the book of Genesis. If you can't find Genesis, get to the altar. We've got bigger fish to fry. The book of Genesis, the first chapter. Gonna make it easy to find today. The book of Genesis, the first chapter. I'm going to start our reading this morning in verse 26. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. When you get there, just please stand for the reading of the word this morning. I promise I'll let you sit for a little while after this. Verse 26, it starts reading like this. It says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. Verse 28, now listen very closely to the very first thing God does after He creates man. "Then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over everything that moves on the earth. And God said, see, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed. To you it shall be for food. Also to every beast of the earth, to every bird of the air, to everything that creeps on the earth in which there is life. I have given every green herb for food, and it is so. Then God saw everything that He had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day." Dear Heavenly Father God, I just pray that You would have Your way, let Your will be accomplished. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You may be seated. Genesis simply means the beginning. That's what it means. The start of something. It is the genesis of everything that we know. The beginning. And in the beginning, the Bible says that God done one thing. He spoke. Before we can go any further, we have to understand the power and the authority in just God's Word, in God's Word. There is so much power and so much authority inside God's Word that the Bible says that He cannot lie and He cannot repent because of the authority and the power that His Word holds. Let me break that down just a little bit simpler for you in case that went over your head. It means something like this. We see this as a piano. But if God was to come into this house, look at this piano and say, that is not a piano, that is a guitar. It would automatically shape-shift and turn into a guitar. And all of us would look at it and say, it is a guitar. And we would have never known it to be anything other than what He called it to be. If God was to come into this house and He was to say that these walls are not brick, they are made of wood, automatically, without hesitation, without a moment, without a twinkling or a blinking of an eye, every brick would turn to wood and we would not ever have known it to be any different because God's Word holds so much power and so much authority. God was able to step out into a dark and void and empty world and begin to speak and say, let there be light. And light came into existence. God said, let there be a divider between the earth and the firmament. And automatically, without hesitation, there was a divider. God spoke, and automatically, without hesitation, God formed the land and the sea and separated them with a word. God's word is all powerful and it holds all authority. Are you with me? But on the sixth day, God does something different. On the sixth day, He chooses to do something abnormal. Kind of like we did this morning. Something out of the ordinary. You see, day one, He spoke and things became. And day two, He spoke and things happened. And day three, and day four, and day five were just like the other three. He spoke and things came into existence. Things became. Things were allowed to happen at the voice of God. But on day six, He looks at the Trinity of the Godhead. And He says, now let us create a man. Let us create something that will operate and function similar to us.
Hallelujah.
But see, if they're going to act outside of everything else that I have already created, maybe I need to create it a little different than everything else I have created. So He reaches down into the dust. And begins to form and shape and mold creation. After He has formed it, the Bible will lead us and teach us and tell us that the next thing He done is that after He had the structure, after He had it formed, He then breathed. And once the breath entered into the man, it became a living soul. You can have structure and you can have the form and everything can look right and everything can be in line and in order, but until the breath enters, there is no life. And so He into man. And man becomes a living soul. But He doesn't stop there. The very next thing that God does, are you following me? I really want you to follow me. The very next thing He does after He makes man and makes man a living soul, the very next thing is He says He blesses them. He blesses them. Now I want to talk just for a few minutes on this topic. Don't move from blessed.
Hallelujah.
Don't move from blessed. Yeah.
Yes.
God, all-powerful, using the very thing that He just created the entire world with, has now took His hands, reached down into the earth, formed a man, breathed life into him, and then He says, now let me put all power and authority on it, and let me speak what I want it to be, and what I want man to be is blessed.
Hallelujah.
That's what I want him to be. I want them to be blessed. This is what I'm putting on them. And the very next thing He does after He blesses them is gives them instruction on what to do next. He says, now be fruitful, multiply, have dominion, subdue, take control. Do this, do this, do this. I have given you this, this, and this. But the very first thing that I ever did is I covered you in a blessing. You see, for so long we have lived this life in humanity and with this idea or this thought that we're cursed and not blessed. That we have to fight for a blessing. That we have to to war after a blessing. But that is not the fact of the matter. The fact of the matter is that from the day He first created man, He blessed it. But something happened. Satan came and he begins to speak and he begins to deceive and he begins to slither around and speak to the woman and begins to draw her. Notice, he doesn't touch her. I want to lay the foundation. I got to lay the foundation. I want you to really get it. He draws her. He don't touch her. He can't curse her. He can't do anything to her. He just draws her. Hey, come look at this. Come look at this. Don't this look good? I noticed that you eat of every other tree. Why not this one? And they begin to have a conversation. And slowly but surely, Eve begins to make her way over to the tree that is in the midst of the garden and is explaining exactly why that she can't have this tree, that she can eat of all the other trees, but God spoke and told my husband, don't eat from this one, and we can't eat from this tree or we'll die. And she's explaining everything, and the Satan, he just continues to draw and continues to deceive because he wants her to move outside of the blessing that is on her life. Let me back up. For so long, we have people, we think blessed is materialistic. New car, hashtag blessed. New house, hashtag blessed. Little baby, hashtag blessed. Things make us blessed because things make us happy. Oh, yeah, I'm getting ready to preach. Things make us happy, and we say happy equals blessed, blessed equals happy. So being blessed means I'm happy. But see, here's what we need to understand. When you break down the word happy, the root word of happy is a Greek word, hap, H-A-P. And hap is the exact Greek word that we get our English word happen. And that means I can't be happy until something happens. But you got to understand something. I may only be happy when something happens, but I'm blessed when nothing is happening. I can be sitting somewhere right by myself in a dark and void world, and I'm still blessed. Nothing's got to happen for me to be blessed. Nothing's got to happen because the reason that we have associated blessed with happy is just because that we've got the wrong definition for blessed. Blessed is this. This is what blessed means according to Scripture. Now you can Google it. You can Webster it. You can do whatever you want to. You're going to get a different definition than what I'm about to give you. But if you really study out what being blessed means in the Bible, this is what it means. It is the innate ability to overcome the enemy. Oh, yes, that's what blessed means. Blessed is the innate ability. What does innate mean? It means natural. It is the natural ability of being able to overcome the enemy. That's what blessed is. Because see, this is blessed. Blessed. Excuse me. Blessed is this. Oh, let me find it. Goodness. Anyways, whatever. Blessed is this. It is when you are standing in the atmosphere of the favor of God. When God blesses man, what he does is he wraps him in his favor. And once you are wrapped in his favor, you then have the natural ability to overcome the enemy. That's what blessed is. The natural. Get that in your spirit. It is the natural ability to overcome the enemy. Notice I did not say that blessed means you do not have enemies. Need I remind you, church, that the Bible says blessed is the man that falls into diverse temptation. That word temptation there means trial. Blessed is the man that falls into diverse, different kinds of trials. Why is the man that falls into different kinds of trials blessed? It is simply because he has the natural ability to overcome every obstacle, every trial, every circumstance, every situation that the enemy has thrown at him. You need to understand that you being here this morning simply means you're blessed. The enemy has tried everything. He's done everything in his power. He has thrown everything except the sink. And then when you turn and look, here comes the sink. But see, here's the thing, church. He wasn't able to destroy you. He was not able to overcome you. He was not able to defeat you because you are blessed. Somebody shout, I'm blessed. Devil, you can throw what you want to throw. You can try what you want to try. But devil, I need to let you know I've got the natural ability to overcome you because I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Oh, you see, this message has really hit me today because the devil's tried everything. He tried to get me sick with the flu, and he kept me out of church on a Sunday. That'll make me madder than anything, Kelsey, to keep me going from where I want to go. You can ask my wife, if I'm wanting to go somewhere and I ain't got the ability, time, or whatever to get there, I get aggravated. I get ill and irritated. It makes me mad because I'm saying I'm a grown man and I'll do what I want to do and I'll go where I want to go. And the only place that I seem to want to go is to the house of God and to be with the like-minded people that want to worship and praise and seek Him just like I do. And you see, the devil tried to stop it and he tried to keep it from happening. But he didn't know that I was blessed and that I got in my prayer time right by myself. Sick and messed up from the feet up, beat up from the floor up. I couldn't figure out why I couldn't quit coughing, couldn't get rid of the temperature, couldn't do this, couldn't do that. But let me tell you what I could do. I could worship right by myself. I could pray right by myself. I could lay hands on myself and prophesy and decree and declare. Why was I able to do it? How was I able to get through it? Let me tell you why. Because I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Ain't nothing got to be going on. And I'm blessed. Ain't nothing got to be showing up. And I'm blessed. I ain't got to have a paycheck rolling in. And I'm blessed. I ain't got to have a new car and a new house. I'm blessed. Why do I worship Him, sister? It's because I'm blessed. Why do I pray to Him like I do? It's because I'm blessed. Why do I preach the way I preach? It's because I'm blessed. I'm blessed. And I'm highly favored by the Most High God. And there ain't no devil that can take it from me. I'm blessed. Can I move on? Satan understood one thing, that one of his own people could not understand in the Old Testament. He understood that he could not curse what God had already put a blessing on. He doesn't have the ability to overturn the word. I wish we could understand that. But we live in a world today where everything is being overturned. Everything that the last administration wants to put into order, this administration has overturned. Every time we think we're going to get a big insurance check, the insurance company overturns it. We think that the judge is going to judge in our favor or whatever. He's going to go in our favor, and then all of a sudden, it's overturned. I'm telling you, we live in a time where everything is overturned. But even the devil knows there is one thing that can never be overturned, and that is the Word of God. Can't overturn it. And he knows it. How many of you remember Baal and Balaam? And all they want to do is curse Israel. But what did the false prophet say? He said, I cannot curse what he has blessed. Satan understands this. Satan is not confused and Satan is not uneducated. Satan knows and understands fully that he cannot curse what has been blessed. So therefore, his only option and his only strategy is to get you to leave the blessing. He wants you to move from blessed because he can't touch what's blessed. So what does he do? He starts trying to draw you out. He starts trying to draw you out. He starts trying to pull you away from the blessed life. He tries to deceive and cause destruction. And you, can I just preach it like I feel it? You're wondering why everything around you is falling apart. It's because you're blessed and he can't touch you. He's tried touching you. He's tried getting you. But you're blessed and he can't touch what's blessed. So he said, let me cause chaos over here. And let me cause confusion over here. And let me sprinkle some destruction on this side. Because I just can't reach them. But maybe if I can draw them out of that blessed shadow, that favored shadow, to see what's going on and see if they might just try and attempt to put their hands on it and try and step out of what's blessed and step into what's cursed. Maybe, just maybe, then I can get my hands on them. You want to know why everything in your life is going crazy? It's because you're blessed. But guess what? You know that you're blessed because you're still here and you're still working and you're still moving, and what is going on around you hasn't got in you. The picture of the ark is the best picture of this. God gave Noah specific instruction on the ark. He said, I want you to pitch it within, and I want you to pitch it without. When you're blessed, you're pitched within, and you're pitched without. The ark went through the storm without the storm getting in the ark. And when you're blessed, you're able to go straight through the storm without the storm getting in you. Do I got any people in here that can say, I've been through the storm? I've seen hell and high water. I've seen chaos and destruction. The devil's tried taking everything, but he couldn't quite reach me because I was just out of his reach and I was standing in blessed. Don't move from blessed. Because you see, just like Adam and Eve, they were drawn outside of the blessing. He couldn't touch them. He couldn't curse them. But he said, maybe I can get them to curse themselves. Maybe, just maybe, I can get them to curse themselves and walk outside of the blessing. If I can get them to step out, then I'll have my hands on them. Then I'll really be able to get them and do whatever it is that I want to do. And you know what it is he wants to do. The Bible says he's only came to do three things, and that is to steal to kill and to destroy. Maybe, just maybe, I can get them to walk out of the blessing and curse themselves. And he draws and he draws, and Eve eats and Adam eats, and next thing we know, they have moved outside of bliss and they have cursed themselves. So many times, we curse ourselves. So many times, we let whatever the enemy's throwing in our direction get our attention, and we step out of the blessing. Adam and Eve eat the fruit and they step out of blessed. And in the New Testament, we have Peter walking on water, and what does Peter do? He looks around, and next thing you know, he has stepped out of the blessing. The list goes on and on and on of person after person that is drawn outside of the blessing. And the problem is sometimes that once we move outside of the blessing, we don't know how to get back. How do I get back to being blessed? How can I be something that God will once again look at and say, I'm placing my blessing on them? It is sin that separates us from the blessing. You need to know something today. Something that I wish I would have found out a long time ago. Temptation is not sin. Being tempted is not a sin. If it is, I'm in trouble. I'm not going to make it. Because I'm tempted every day. I'm tempted to murder. Every day. I'm tempted to... I want to give somebody a blessing. I want to bless them out is what I want to do. He said, bless those that curse you. I blessed them. God blessed them. I blessed them right out the door. But how do I get back to bless? Noah said when he was in the ark, he understood that the earth had been cursed and that God had no choice but to send a flood and to wash out and destroy every wicked thing that was on the earth. And the first thing that Noah does when he steps off the boat is he says, how do I make sure that I stay blessed? And he looks around and he sees what he has. He says, what do I have? I have animals. I have an altar. I need a sacrifice to make sure that I stay blessed. You need to look around and you need to see what you've got. What do I still have that I can use? What do I have to make sure, first of all, that I don't move from blessed in the first place? Well, the enemy has took my happiness. Okay. Well, the enemy has took my joy. The enemy has took my praise. I can't even praise. I can't even worship anymore. The only thing I have is a request. Well, the Bible says, make your request made known unto the Lord. If all I've got is a request, if all I've got is a complaint, I will use my complaint to make sure that I stay blessed. If all I've got is a shout, I will shout and make sure that I stay blessed. If all I can do is dance,
I will dance and make sure that I stay blessed. But here's my question. Once I've moved outside of blessed, how do I get back? How do I get back? Sin is what separates us. There's only one thing that can bring us back. And that is the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made on the cross. His blood is what makes us blessed. Hallelujah. Don't move from blessed. Don't move from blessed. But if you move from blessed, don't let the devil make you think that there's not a way back. Amen. Amen. Let's stand all over the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Father God, we thank you for everything that has taken place here today. God, I pray right now that your word has went forth and it has accomplished what you have wanted it to set out to do. I pray that it would go down into the hearts and minds of all of us, God, and it would grow deep roots and stay with us, God. And every time that we're faced with a trial, every time that we're faced with a circumstance, we will say, we are not moving from blessed. I'm going to stay here. I'm going to stay with you. God, if there's ever a time that we find ourselves outside of blessed, where we have felt short, and God, we know that there's going to come a time in each and every single one of us, God, that we are going to fall short. Your word says all have fallen short. And God, we know that there's going to come that day, and there's going to come those moments. And God, I just pray that you would remind us of what we have heard here this morning. And we will say we don't have to stay here. That there is a way back to the blessing. And His name is Jesus Christ. And we give you all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name.
Hey guys, I hope today's message has encouraged you and has built your faith. Because our Bibles tell us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And I pray that we've placed the seed of faith inside of you today. If there's anything that you would like to request prayer for, or anything like that, you can always go to our website at houseofthepromisedchurch.com. Go to the link that says prayer request and send in any prayer requests that you may have. But I want to take just for a few minutes and pray with you guys that the Holy Spirit would just continue to lead you and guide you and direct you in the way that you should go. Dear Heavenly Father, we just pray right now and we ask that any situation, any circumstance that anybody may be facing right now, God, God, I pray that you would intervene like only you can, God. I pray that your healing power, God, would go forth and touch them that are sick. Your delivering power would go forth and free them that are in captivity and save those that are lost, God. God, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for watching and be blessed.